Spotlight on Portland, brought to you by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenters today are Derrick Olsen, a graduate of the Master's degree in the School of Foreign Service, 1992, and Vice President of Regional Strategy and Coordination at Greater Portland, Inc. Our second presenter is John Casey, who graduated from the college in 1996, and is a partner in the Portland office of K&L Gates LLP. We are thrilled to have Derrick and John here today. They're both actively involved in the Alumni Club of Oregon, so this webinar is co-sponsored with the Alumni Club. Before I turn it over to them, I just want to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded, and you can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services. You'll also see I sent out the link directly in the chat area on your control panel. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type your questions into the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel. Derrick and John are planning to answer as many questions as time will allow and are leaving plenty of time for Q&A, so please just type in your questions as you think of them while they're speaking, and then we'll pause at the end. Afterwards, I will email everyone a copy of their slides, so don't feel like you have to write everything down. And if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area or visit the GoToWebinar helpline. Without further ado, I'll tell you a bit more about our presenters. As I said, Derrick Olsen is the Vice President of Regional Strategy and Coordination at Greater Portland, Inc., a regional economic development organization where he leads the region's implementation of the Greater Portland Export Initiative and Foreign Direct Investment Pilot, and provides coordination and project management services to the region's economic development community. Previously, Derrick managed international trade and investment issues for over 4 years with Business Oregon, Oregon Business Development Department. And he also has over 13 years of experience managing political and economic issues as a foreign service officer for the U.S. Department of State in Latin America, Asia, and D.C. Derrick was just telling me he grew up in Portland, so obviously he is an ideal person to discuss the city to everyone today. And John Casey is a partner in the Portland office of K&L Gates LLP, a global law firm. Casey focuses his practice on complex commercial disputes, including securities litigation, class action defense, product liability, intellectual property disputes, insurance coverage disputes, contract disputes, and employment litigation. He has extensive experience in all aspects of litigation, including fact and expert discovery, motion practice, and trial. Before moving to Portland in 2012, John was a partner at Latham & Watkins LLP in Chicago and was a very active club member there. So now he's bringing that activity over to Portland. And it's great to have both perspectives on the line, someone who's getting adjusted in the city and can speak to that, and then someone who has been there for a long time. So Derrick and John, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. I'll now turn it over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Sarah. And I wanted to thank the 6 people who are actually listening to this this program today, which I think includes myself, Derrick, and Sarah. So we're going to jump into some slides in a bit, but the first thing I wanted to do was to have everybody click on a video. And Sarah, maybe you can help us out with this. Here is the video, yeah. But I think Sarah is going to give everybody a YouTube link that you all can click and watch.
Yeah, so if everyone will go down to the chat area, you'll see that YouTube link right there. John and Derrick, there are actually 13 people on the line outside of us. So.
Okay, well, that's great. Okay, so everybody click on the link, and when it's done, we'll jump back into the program. Okay. Well, hopefully everyone is finished with the video. At this point, I'm not sure we even need to do the presentation with that. But so the way this is going to break down is, this is John Casey, by the way. I'm going to start with the easy stuff, with the fluff. Basically, with all the information you probably already know about Portland and Oregon and just what a great place it is to live, we're very fortunate to have Derrick Olsen here as well. Derrick is going to talk to you about what you may not know, which is how Portland is really growing its economy and establishing itself as a destination spot, not just for hipsters who like to cure their own meats, but for real businesses. And Derrick is an expert on this issue, and we're very fortunate to have him with us today. Just a quick background on me, and Sarah gave you kind of the formal bio, but I grew up in Washington, D.C., and grew up a Georgetown basketball fanatic. I graduated from the college in 1996 and was crying in my beer mug at the Tombs when Ray Allen hit that ridiculous circus shot to beat us in the 1996 Big East tournament. Some of you may remember that game. So grew up in D.C., met my wife at Georgetown, and went to law school in her hometown of Chicago, where I started to practice about 13 or 14 years ago. Had a family there, but moved to Portland 2 years ago. And it's interesting. My whole family, as I said, was on the East Coast, but everybody migrated west. First to the Bay Area and then to Portland, Oregon. And we would visit Portland every year in the summer, of course, when the weather was pretty nice. And we just fell in love with the area. And you can look at this first slide and see why. In terms of natural beauty, it doesn't get any better. You know, I've fallen into one of the Portland stereotypes in that I bike to work most days. It's about a 12-minute bike ride. And then in terms of the outdoor stuff, you've got Mount Hood. You can see a picture of Mount Hood on the lower right. It's about, you know, hour away, hour and 15 minutes away. And you've got skiing there, endless hiking and camping opportunities. Multnomah Falls is in the Columbia River Gorge, and it's, you know picturesque. You can see a picturesque waterfall. Forest Park is actually in the city of Portland, in Portland proper, and it's an enormous forest preserve that offers endless hiking opportunities. Have not yet tried urban kayaking, but maybe one day we'll get to that. The thing that's interesting, too, as a city kid from D.C. and then Chicago, you know, I was a little skeptical whether or not I would kind of embrace this outdoorsy lifestyle, but we bought in, and it's been fun seeing the kids kind of change. They're still city kids, because Portland is a great city, but they're becoming Oregon kids, you know, into camping and in the outdoors, and that's been a real treat. That's the outdoors. Obviously, we have it here in abundance, and that's what we're known for. Food and drink. So, you know, I love good beer. I love good food, and we've got that here as well. We've got more breweries in Portland per capita than anywhere in the world. You see on the bottom right, there's a reference to food carts. And I think when I was in Chicago, the food cart phenomenon was starting to happen. But really, I don't know if it started here, but it really took off here. And frankly, That is my lunch most days. You've got pods of food carts all over the city, and it's high quality stuff. You know, it seems a little sketchy. You know, you're getting your meal out of a truck, but it's very, very good stuff. Obviously, we've got the Willamette Valley, and you've probably heard of our Pinot Noirs. That's what the region is famous for. Very good wine, very good coffee. And so you've got, you know, the food carts and that scene, but you also have, like, really foodie high-end restaurants as well. I mean, you know, like most big cities, so nothing crazy there. But a lot of good food and good drinks. So I wanted to put together a slide about just Portland being a great place for family. I mentioned that we have three young kids, and we thought it was now or never to make a big move, and very, very glad we did. There's so many opportunities for kids to just get out there and explore. It's known as I call it a work-to-live culture as opposed to live-to-work. Frankly, I think we could use a bit more business energy, but you're seeing more and more of that. It's pretty interesting. So we've met a bunch of families where my kids go to school, and I'd say about 90% of the families we met, the parents are not from here. They're from other places. And so you've got a lot of kind of young talent, people who are in big cities like Chicago, and a ton of people from the Bay Area, Southern California, East Coast, people who just want to be here, very, very talented, creative people. And that's bringing a ton of culture to the city. So you get you're getting a lot of new and smart and energetic people in the city, and it's good family living too. So this slide just highlights some of the perks of Portland. We've got a great public transportation system. As I said, it's consistently ranked as one of the best biking cities in the world, and a ton of arts and a ton of culture. Bottom line, in my view, is that it's the best of both worlds. You've got a very, very good and growing and developing business climate, but you also have a standard of living which is terrific, and it's just been a blast. I will say, Chicago, there for 15 years. And I think it's the quintessential American city. And as a city, you can't beat it. But the winters there get old. And we're very happy to be here. So that was my fluff. That was the easy stuff. Now I'm going to turn it over to Derrick, who's going to talk about some economic development issues and what's happening in that sense. This is my last slide. Most importantly, we do put birds on things. So forgot about that one. Okay, here's Derrick.
All right, thanks, John. We can circle back to dive into some more of those when we go to Q&A, because I think the quality of life is really an important factor, especially for people like yourselves who may be considering this as a place to relocate. And it's a real strength when we talk to companies looking at the region. Again, I'm Derrick Olsen. And I graduated as a Master of Science in Foreign Service, 1992, from the School of Foreign Service. So my bent really has been international. And when we talk about the region, this presentation is, and the video, as you probably can tell, is more designed a little bit more for domestic audiences. But we really are increasingly being asked these questions from folks around the globe, because to the extent that Portland is known, it's with a positive green reputation. And what we'd like to talk a little bit more today is why it's also a great place to do business. So Greater Portland, Inc., where I work, is a public-private nonprofit. John, in fact, is on our board on behalf of K&L Gates, representing a group of investors. We have public sector and private sector investors on us that really come together to try to move the economy forward. We are a unique metropolitan area in that, as opposed to many that are within just one state, we straddle the border, the Columbia River, with Southwest Washington. So we have five counties in our metropolitan statistical area from Oregon and two on the Southwest Washington side. And that really is a key part of our region, as we'll talk, because both sides bring strengths. And the Southwest Washington area economically is much more tied to the Portland metro economy than it is to Seattle. And as you can see from the map on the left, we are many of our competitors, but also cities really that we're in the supply chain of are up and down the West Coast. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as we go on. This slide just gives you an idea of Greater Portland. and Greater Portland, Inc., our organization, and the type of work we do. I'm sure many of the cities that you're in will have similar organizations. I just was in Phoenix in a panel and with the head of the Phoenix version of Greater Portland, and we met recently. John and I were on a regional trip to Pittsburgh looking at some of the neat things that they do there, and we met with some of the folks that are on the leadership of the economic development community. So it's not a unique approach, but I think it is one that is relatively new for Portland, and we really want to be able to, again, emphasize and grow the business aspects in addition to all the great qualities of life. So as you can see, we have sort of three main areas we focus on. We call first one is uniting regionally to compete globally, which is really regionally collaborating on economic development efforts with economic summits, with partnerships with state, federal, county, cities, et cetera. Our second campaign, Choose Greater Portland, which is this type of work like we're talking today, where it's business recruitment, marketing, and talking about why Greater Portland is a great place to do business, both domestically and internationally. We preach that message. And then the third campaign, Stay and Grow in Greater Portland, which is our efforts focused on business retention, which for those of you involved in economic development will know that's where the largest amount of job growth comes, usually from existing companies. So, for instance, while in recruitment, we look to get expansion opportunities from companies based in other parts of the U.S. or the world, we don't look to try to steal companies. That's not our game. I mean, obviously, if a company chooses to move here, we will talk to them. But our focus is to look as this is a place for you to expand. But that is really part of a larger strategy, again, with the retention that talks about how can we help existing companies grow. Sarah mentioned our work with the Greater Portland Export Initiative. I encourage you, for those interested in international issues, to dive in a little bit more on that. It's a unique initiative that about 20-some metros in the U.S. are doing in conjunction with the Brookings Institution, and it's really trying to look at helping grow small, medium-sized companies' exports at the metro level. Where the heart of the nation's economy is. And we've recently expanded it, as Sarah mentioned, to look at foreign direct investment and how do we expand that. We'll talk a little bit about some of the, you know, nuts and bolts about why this is a great place to do business and, again, why it is cost-effective. We are one of the lowest costs of living on the West Coast. And, again, we are typically looked at by companies that, whether they're international or they're on the East Coast of the U.S., they're looking to expand to the West Coast, but they're looking for something with a little more affordable and a little less commuting traffic time, as we'll get into, than some of our other sister cities along the West Coast of the U.S. So whether you're talking residential or you're talking commercial, it is very competitive against other regions in the West Coast. Now, obviously, we're a little more expensive than some other parts of the U.S., but we are not the lowest cost competition for the U.S. That's not our game. Again, we're lowest cost on the West Coast, but we are high efficiency, highly effective, good ROI place to do business. I'll dive into a little bit of that more on when we talk about manufacturing. One of the reasons, again, why we're a cost-effective place to do business is we have clean, abundant, and affordable water. That's critical for the high-tech industry as well as the abundant hydropower, which leads to the next point on electricity. We have stable and inexpensive, and about 70% in the Greater Portland region comes from non-carbon generating sources. So we're talking primarily hydropower that's it's been existing for a while, but increasingly large amounts of wind power. John referred to the Columbia River Gorge. It's not only beautiful, but right when you get out of the scenic area, it is a fantastic place to generate wind energy. And so we have both on the Oregon and the Washington side a tremendous amount of wind power. We have limited but growing solar power, and in fact we have, as referred to in the video, the largest North American solar manufacturer here based in the Portland area, Solar World. tax climate. I think this is an important one to emphasize because a lot of times people fear or they've had misperceptions of high tax. And really, if you look at this study from the Tax Foundation, we're very competitive when it comes to business taxes. Washington, even more so, number six state in the U.S., with Oregon number 12, as far as one being the best tax business tax climate, 50 being the worst. Notable, again, the unique aspect of having a bi-state region, it really depends on the type of business you want to operate. So there's no income tax in Washington, but there's no sales tax in Oregon. And, for instance, the Oregon has a single sales factor tax, which means essentially a company like an Intel or a Nike or another large company that's making a lot of products, they're taxed on what they produce and sell locally. And so goods that are exported domestically or internationally, then they're not taxed on those. So this has been a very historically, since this change was made a couple decades ago, been very good for companies that do production, designed for exporting. Because obviously, while we're a significant metro area, the Oregon, Washington is not a huge market. And so many of our companies look domestically and through the export initiative, we're trying to encourage them to increasingly look internationally where most of the customers are. We have excellent air ties, and I think this travel is key. One thing that's really unique about Portland International Airport, not only is it a great place to travel through, for those of you who haven't visited it, I mean, it's one airport of the year from Condé Nast magazine for like four of the last 5 years. And it's one thing that makes it unique is retailers and restaurants there, they must charge the same prices they would charge outside the airport. And in return for that, the airport gives them very competitive fare lease rates. And so it makes for the customer quite a positive experience. But leaving that aside, it just has very good air ties, and that's really critical in this day and age, especially for business. We're the smallest metro in the U.S. that has both a nonstop to Asia with Tokyo and Europe to Amsterdam. Those are both on Delta Airlines, and I really can't emphasize how important those are. There's a lot of cities quite larger than us that only have one or the other. And so this gives the opportunity for a business here to quickly get to either Europe or Asia, which are the largest export markets and the largest sources of foreign direct investment and business ties to this region. And then we have very strong domestic ties, airline ties. In fact, I just flew back on our nonstop from D.C. not too long ago. Again, closely connected in, as you'll see here, it's quite easy to get to. In fact, you can take the light rail MAX, as it's called, from the suburbs to the airport without ever having to use a car. And it's so it's kind of a convenient greenway to travel as well. As was talked about in the video, and John has talked about with some of the families he's met personally, we are a magnet for young, highly educated talent. We have, as you can see from the graphs, quite a large percentage of our population, especially in comparison to some other metro areas, a large percentage of folks who have moved to the region relatively recently, and also a large percentage of those folks who moved in and are higher educated. So we attract college-educated young adults. I mean, this is why you get the whole Portlandia joke and why this is where people go to retire. And, the show, while based on some truths, it's fundamentally that is not a truth because the neat thing is we have young people who come here to work. They just work often, as John said, they work to live. They don't live to work. So they have more flexibility in their approach to it. And really, that brings a lot of creativity. And then our challenge as Greater Portland Inc. is to continue to attract new businesses and help existing businesses grow so that talent that continues to come in has great opportunities for jobs. These are some of the accolades. I won't go into all the details, but if you've seen the slide, we're, again, not only a great place to live, and we could show slide after slide of why it's a wonderful place to live, this is also a great place to do business. And so We get accolades on being one of the smartest cities, about growth prospects. The state of Oregon recently was awarded the most efficient manufacturing state as far as workforce efficiency. And we often rank as a state right below Indiana as far as the highest per capita percentage of manufacturing in our economy. So we are, as we mentioned in the video, this is a place where we build things or create things. But we really have an emphasis on what we call here the traded sector, goods and services that we can create here efficiently to sell outside the region. And flowing to this next slide, this will show you some of those companies that reflect that ethos. So Intel, a lot of people don't realize this, while they're a California headquartered company, their largest concentration and their highest, most accelerated, highest value work is done here in the greater Portland area. They're by far and away our largest private employer in the trade sector, and they do some amazing work here. Nike, again, a top company who does some incredible design work here and marketing and others. They headquarter our, hold down our athletic and outdoor cluster, as we call it. I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. Daimler Trucks North America, this large German company I recently saw is the number one German investor in the U.S., and so they have their trucks headquarters here, where they both have headquarter jobs and also blue-collar manufacturing jobs, which is really the kind of mix often you'll see here. We have a lot of companies, for instance, in the renewable energy, who have their headquarters, sales and service here, but then you also have manufacturing jobs as well. And as you look down the line in the top 10, you see a lot of either high-tech or manufacturing jobs. Boeing is a very significant facility here. Precision Castparts, who's along with Nike, is our two Fortune 500 companies here. Precision, you probably not have heard of, but they do tremendously advanced manufacturing in the Boeing and Airbus supply chain, as well as for power generation equipment. So really some advanced manufacturing. This slide shows some of the companies that have recently invested in here or have doubled down on their investment. So you saw Nike, Intel, and Daimler on the top 10 employers list. All of them have recently redoubled their investment. Huge construction going on in the Intel facilities. Nike as well is expanding. Daimler just opened recently their new North American truck headquarter. Airbnb and the vacation home rental website and Salesforce.com does CRM software have both recently expanded in the Portland area, highlighting a real boom in software companies, both the big names like this and also the smaller ones that are flourishing in downtown Portland and also in the suburbs like Salesforce. John mentioned this. I won't go into details, but we have it's a great place to get around to work or fun. We have a very efficient, widely used transit system that has the light rail, one of the only commuter suburb-to-suburb commuter rails, the West Side Express service. And in Southwest Washington also has bus routes connecting to Portland. And as John mentioned, we'd be remiss not to mention the biking. And it is a very high percentage of folks that bike to work. It's really quite astounding. We usually compete with Minneapolis as the number one bike city. I guess they sometimes bike in the winter with studded tires, so they may be slightly more committed than us, but it is part of life here. You can't go a day here without seeing hundreds of people biking to and from work. It's really quite striking. And it gives the city, frankly, between the bikes and the light rail, what we hear from some of our European visitors is it gives it somewhat of a European feel. Obviously, it's, we're still a very American city, but because of the unique transportation options, it gives it a different type of a feel. And I won't belabor this slide, but just that means there's less time spent in rush hour traffic, which is nice. And while it's not perfect, and we have faced traffic challenges like the rest of the metro areas out there, it makes it quite competitive. And because it's a very livable city, people live fairly close in, so they don't need a long commute time. And really, this ties into our green ethos, sustainability focus. We use a much higher percentage of renewable energy. Many of us opt to pay a little extra on our utility bills to help subsidize renewable energy and research into that. We have very high recycling rates. Of course, you probably know that Oregon, you might have heard if you're into green and recycling, that Oregon is one of the first states to have recycling of pop cans and bottles. We are very focused on stormwater management to reduce pollution. So really, it's a big focus of what we do, and we have a lot of companies who make money doing this. In fact, through the Export Initiative, we have something called We Build Green Cities, which is an effort through our partners at the Portland Development Commission to help those companies sell their products and services abroad to countries that are looking to learn on green building design and green products. And that means we have good air quality, too. We recently put together this map because we were getting questions from companies in other parts of the U.S. asking about air pollution. And as you can see, it's not an issue here. It is, and it's quite striking, and it's an important part of why a lot of people like to live here. I'm going to touch a little bit on, just to close up the presentation and before we get to the Q&A, on some of our leading sectors in manufacturing and services, and we can talk them more in detail. So I won't read all these bulletins, but again, just it's hard to emphasize how important the semiconductor industry is to this area. It's for those of you familiar with the location quotient, it basically means, you know, how high a percentage do you have compared to the national average, and we are way up there on semiconductors. In addition to Intel, we have ON Semiconductor, TriQuint, you may have heard of because they make some of the chips that go into iPhones. There's a lot of great companies here. That has also given us strength in the silicon area, which led to some of the development of the solar industry in the region. I talked about advanced manufacturing. It really is a heart of the Portland economy and continues very strong. We recently had a merger here. Vigor, mentioned at the bottom of the slide, just recently purchased Oregon Ironworks, who makes streetcars, the only domestic company making streetcars, selling not only in Portland but in other cities in the U.S. So it's very strong, very advanced in that supply chain, as I mentioned, with Boeing, up to the north of us. And software and information technology, again, we are in the supply chain often both in the Seattle area and in the Bay Area to the south of us. And as John mentioned, we have a lot of folks who've come up from the Bay Area. Because we have such good ties to our airport here, there's many companies, as you'll see at the bottom, Mozilla, Salesforce, et cetera, that will have a expanded facility here in the Portland area. You know, keep their headquarters up in Seattle or in the Bay Area, and then they can commute back and forth as needed. And really, we're seeing more and more companies doing this, and that's a hot area, the software, and it connects in well with hardware. One last thing that I haven't mentioned, we don't have a slide specifically on, but athletic and outdoor is the other big sector here in the region, and that in addition to Nike, what you may not know is it's really become a hub for design and manufacturing here. And so Nike's here. We also have Adidas North American headquarters, Columbia Sportswear is headquartered here. And then we have a lot of smaller companies that do some really interesting manufacturing. We have a strong knife sector that is both domestically owned and foreign-owned companies that do hunting and the multi-tools.
Leatherman? Are they
yeah.
Here?
A Leatherman is one of the leading companies in that, Gerber, Kershaw. It's a really a neat kind of cluster. And then, as was mentioned in the video, we have a lot of unique smaller outdoor and apparel kind of clothing companies, Keen, that make some of their boots here and others. So it's a hot area. So what this really means is we have a robust economy with a highly educated, motivated young workforce. And our job as a region, what John and I are trying to do is really to help continue that growth. And we look for people like you who are interested in enjoying this great quality of life to help build the businesses, to help expand the businesses, to create those new Nikes and Precision Castparts. Who's going to be that next big business? And so it's great to be able to talk to you about this today. And, Sarah, I think I'll stop here, and then maybe we can ask for questions, and then we can talk and dive into whatever the audience would like to hear.
All right, wonderful. Well, thank you so much for that great information. I'm certainly ready to go visit Portland. We have someone who joined a bit late, so apologies if you feel like you're repeating yourself, but would you provide some more information around the cost of housing, so what the prices are like, and if it's typically older construction or newer projects going up?
Yeah, so I can just speak anecdotally about this. It's a tight market. I think Oregon was the most moved into state in the nation last year. And that's, you know, with that, it creates a tighter housing market as compared to Chicago. So I lived in Evanston, Illinois, which is a suburb of Chicago, just north of the city. And I can tell you it's cheaper than that. It's cheaper than Chicago. It's much cheaper than Bay Area in other big cities. I know it's cheaper than D.C. But you know it is getting a little bit tighter, and stuff is not, houses are not on the market as long as they used to be, as people are finding Portland more of a desirable place to live. But you don't obviously just have the city. The city has a tight boundary limit. That's where we live. But there are a number of really excellent suburbs sort of surrounding the city as well, and you know, you can find good places there. But I'll let Derrick speak to it.
Yeah, just to add on, I think John was on the money what he was saying. Just as far as numbers, the and if you missed it, it was on slide 11, and you'll see it when Sarah sends it out. But so the average median home value, $246,000, which is above the national of $212,000, but significantly less than other major metros on the West Coast, so Seattle, San Francisco, et cetera. Likewise, the average apartment rent is slightly less than the national, but significantly less than some of the other metro areas on the West Coast. Again, as it sort of goes along with what we mentioned before, is about a place to live and cost of business. We are not going to win on the lowest cost compared to all the metro areas in the U.S., but I think when you compare it to other key metros on the West Coast or other metros that might be, you know, reasonable competitors, we stack up very well.
Yeah, I will tell you, we were pleased when we were looking for houses as compared to, you know, comparable houses in the Chicago area. We were pleased with what we found. As with anything, I mean, the better neighborhood you're in, the more you're going to pay.
And I can say one of the interesting things, having grown up here, is you've had an increasing number of people, again, as John is evidence of this, who've moved here for the quality of life, and part of that is the cost of housing. So there's a significant number of folks who used to live in California, for instance, probably the largest number of folks who've moved in, and cost of living is one of the reasons they've chosen to move here.
All right, wonderful. And so any tips for job searching when you're going to Portland? We have someone here who is a mid-career professional with 9 years of government experience and a master's in policy management. So obviously that's specific. If you can speak to that, great. But in general, sure. If you can give some job search advice, that would be wonderful.
Right. Well, first of all, I'd be happy to talk to, I'm sure John probably would too, if anybody later, you know, through the Career Network wants to get in touch with us or through Sarah. I've done that with a lot of Georgetown alums. I would say it is a very competitive place to get a job, again, because you have a lot of, as you've seen from our, it's not just hype, it's the truth. We do have very highly educated folks moving here, and so they are competing against jobs. And a company, you know, like an Intel or Nike can hire someone from anywhere knowing that they will be quite happy to move here. And that really makes it unique compared to other parts of the country sometimes, where they may have good jobs, but people are not as eager to move there. So you need to be realistic that it will be competitive. Now, that having been said, There's a lot of very good opportunities. There's an entrepreneurial culture that is increasingly growing. It is a city where people will happily give you of their time to talk you through on this. So people will do informational interviews quite readily. I would suggest that you start investing that time. You can sign up, find the sector you're interested in, sign up for those e-newsletters. Start looking at either the Portland Business Journal or the Oregonian, which are the two major print press services, which have a lot of great information. Start getting a feel for that, and then plan a trip out here to get a sense of the city and the region, set up some informational interviews. I mean, people can be quite generous in helping you, and I think that can give you a better sense of the opportunities.
Yeah, no, I echo all of that. I mean, that's terrific advice. There is a, not a huge, but an active Georgetown network out here, and that's an excellent place to start. As Derrick said, I'd be happy to talk to anyone at any time. And one thing that's interesting, and again, this is echoing what Derrick said, but there are so many people here like me, right, who lived in, Chicago or the Bay Area or New York or D.C. who wanted to change, their lives and wanted to just be in Portland, because Portland is terrific. And so given that, I think people will give of their time because they say, look, I was in your shoes 5 years ago. I didn't know many people, and I'd be happy to grab a drink or have lunch with you. So it's a lot of pounding the pavement, networking, and as Derrick said, we'd be thrilled to talk to anyone who's interested.
Okay. All right. Next question. Can you provide some insight on the education system, i.e. public schools, for anyone who's planning to move with small children?
Yeah, well, I guess I can start. So I live in the city. I'm on the east side in a neighborhood called Laurelhurst, and we have three young kids, ages, my youngest just turned four, actually, 4 through 7. Our two oldest kids are in the public school in the city. In our neighborhood, which we've been very pleased with. There's also an excellent Catholic grade school right in the neighborhood. I guess my impression is that it really kind of depends on the neighborhood. There are good, high-quality public schools, but I think some are better than others. We're at a school where it's K-8, which is important to us. Our public high school is Grant High School, which is a very high quality school. At that point, we may consider private, we may consider Catholic, I've heard very, very good things about Grant High School. Lincoln High School is another one I've heard very good things about, which is a public school in the city. Like most big cities, I think you're going to want to do your research about your particular public school, and there's a ton of resources out there. We look very closely at this. We also were fortunate to have my brother also live in Laurelhurst, and he's got three kids like us, and his kids were at Laurelhurst, and their, education is very important to them, and that was a big help for us. So I think you can get a high-quality education in the public schools in the city. I think you need to do some diligence in terms of the specific neighborhood you want to live.
Yeah, and just to follow on to that, I live in the suburbs, and our kids both go to a public high school, and we're very happy with it. And, there's challenges like any school system in the U.S. with funding and, class size and all that, but there's also real strengths with international baccalaureate programs in many of the high schools, including the one my kids go to. Some of the other schools that don't have international baccalaureate focus on AP, so there's some really advanced work being done. Also, for the adult continuing education, we have an excellent community college system that's very large in the Portland area, led by Portland Community College, and Portland State University, which is increasingly growing right here in the city and it has a big sustainability focus, our partners. So, you want to do your research and figure out what's the best option for you, but I think most people can find something that works for their families.
All right. And so you've talked a lot today about the positives of moving to Portland, but can you say here what Portland might be what they might be undoing. So is there an issue being ignored that maybe could reverse Portland? I mean, not to speak negatively, but just for people who are thinking about the big picture of moving to the city.
Yeah, and well, we don't want to be, we like to call ourselves Beervana because we have a lot of beer, and it really is, but it's not Nirvana. I mean, we don't do everything right here, and the weather in the middle of February can get gray and drizzly. So, you know, our challenges, you know, in some respects are the ones on the economic development. Workforce is a big issue. So we have a lot of people moving in, but are they the talent that the business needs? So, you know, this is a hot market right now for software engineers, and frankly, we don't have enough. Yeah. So there are some areas like that where we really need to focus, and part of that's going to be recruiting great new people like you to move in. Some of it's going to be, you know, working to get that from our existing education and workforce training system. You know, and we struggle like a lot of other major metropolitan areas with infrastructure, making sure that we're making the right investments. And you might have heard we've had a challenging sort of setback about rebuilding a bridge going from Portland to the suburb in Southwest Washington, Vancouver, along the I-5 interstate. And so that was sort of a major setback. On the other hand, at the same time, I think as John might have mentioned in one of his slides, we're building the only non-private car bridge in the U.S. that's going to have light rail, pedestrians, bicycles. So, you know, I'd say we do innovative work. It's not perfect work, but we really, the positives by far outweigh the negatives. I don't know, John, if you want to chip anything.
No, again, I think you hit on the head. You know, the stereotype is, as Derrick mentioned, if you watch Portlandia, which is pretty funny, it's where the young go to retire, right? And so the image is you've got all these young, highly educated hipsters in flannel who are just raising their backyard chickens and living off nature and brewing their own beer. And look, there's some truth to that, but that is that's not all there is, certainly. You know, in comparing it to, so I was in Chicago, as I said, for 15 years practicing law. I went to school there, law school there. And Chicago is a great, great, bustling business city with a ton of energy, and it's a great place to practice. With Portland, again, I'd say the culture here is more work to live, and I think, if anything, we could use a little bit more, as I said, of that hustle-bustle, that business energy. But just, I've been here 2 years, and I'm already seeing that in the people that I've been meeting and getting involved in Greater Portland, in meeting my kids' friends' parents at school who are, you know, from different parts of the country and who are bringing a real ethic, a work ethic, a business ethic to the community. And it's exciting to be a part of that. We need more, but we're doing good work and we're getting there.
Okay. And just to go off of what you said about how people there are working to live, they're not living to work, how can you see that in various aspects around you in the community?
I mean, it's everywhere. I mean, you know, you see people, you know, biking into work. You see people, you know, every weekend taking some, I mean, it's crazy. I mean, you hop in the car on a Saturday morning and you just go. You go an hour, and you're, you know, hour and a half, you're at the coast. You're at the most beautiful coastline in the world. It's not great for swimming, but it's breathtaking and surfing. Or you go east, and you're skiing. Or you go south, and you're, you know, in the wine country. Or a few, you know, further hours south, you're at a different range of mountains, skiing down there in Bend. And so literally, it's, you know, you see – how many minivans do you see with, like, those big containers on top where you throw all your camping gear and, you know, skiing equipment and stuff like that? You cannot escape that sort of that energy here. People just want to get out and do things, and it's great.
Yeah, and I would just say you see it also in the fact that people are willing to be paid less to work here.
Yeah.
I mean, that's one of the reasons why we have a lower cost of living is, frankly, the per capita income is not as high as some of the other areas. And so that, for us, that's a challenge. We want to grow that because that helps support public services and education and everything. But when you look behind those numbers a little bit more, because I've seen some of the studies, it means that people are willing to accept less or work a little less because they want to spend time with their family, they want to spend time outdoors. It's a very, you know, again, a different approach than in a lot of metro areas. And I think the best employers here recognize that, and they build that into their benefits or their approach to the work style.
Absolutely.
Okay. And what do you recommend to someone who's considering a relocation to Portland who has no ties to the city?
Well, you know, I don't think you really need any. In fact, if you need some here, you got John and you have me. And again, we do have an active club here. One of our other board members, Mark Gans from Cambia Health Solutions, which runs Blue Cross Blue Shield, is of Oregon, is a Georgetown alum as well. So there are a lot of alums in the business community here. It's, again, do your homework. You know, get a feel for the place. It is a unique culture. You can do some of that, as I was mentioning, online or by subscribing to some of these services. And then come out here, take a vacation first, like John said, to get a sense for it and if it's a good fit. And you will soon grow ties. I mean, the Chamber of Commerce here has emerging professionals group. Someone mentioned earlier they were talking about, you know, working in government. There's emerging local governmental leaders group. There's a lot of these groups like this. World Affairs Council is a young professionals. There's so many people in this type of, you know, who are moving here, and they're kicking around different ideas. There's a lot of almost like support groups where you can network and meet people. And so I would just dive in and start doing it. Again, be prepared for competition because there's going to be a lot of other people out there who are thinking the same thing you are.
Yeah. No, I think you nailed it again. Just come out here, take a visit. We'll grab a beer, and we'll talk.
Yes, you said it right there. The fact that there's an active alumni club, and obviously you two just volunteered your time to do this session. There are connections out there, and the power of the Hoya Network is strong. We don't have any more questions at this time, so John and Derrick, is there anything else you'd like to add while we wrap it up?
No, I just wanted to thank everyone for listening in, and as I said, please just do not hesitate to reach out to us if you're thinking about a move or you just want to learn more about the city.
Thanks again, everyone, for participating. I hope this has been helpful to add some detail behind the positive press out there, and love to follow up, and wish you all the best, and thanks again, Georgetown Alumni Career Services, for putting this on.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Sarah. Absolutely. And just remember, everyone, this session was recorded. It will be up on our YouTube channel. I'll be sending out the slides. And for those of you who actually are looking for new jobs in Portland, we're doing a webinar next month on how to interview. So make sure you tune into that. And as always, you can send us your resume if you need to. Have a good day, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Sarah.
Bye.